I am thrilled for what we're going to be talking about for the next 4 weeks, because I think it's so important to who we are and who we are becoming. I think it's so important to who God is calling us as a church to be. Like, God is up to a move right now that is surprising us, and we're just trying to figure out, God, what are you doing? We were able, if you were here last weekend, to celebrate 59 women and men, girls and boys, who followed Jesus in baptism in the middle of summertime. 59, and we're just thrilled with that. As best we can tell, we've had hundreds and hundreds stand up to say, I believe, hundreds and hundreds of first-time guests this year. Last week, we had the biggest weekend of summer attendance ever. We were seven people shy of 3,000 last weekend in the middle of summertime. And we're just saying, God, what are you doing? We had, I think for the first time I can remember, more preschoolers than elementary kids last week. And some of you, like, you're having babies and like lots of babies. And I just say, bless you, keep doing that. Or adopt them, foster, like whatever it takes for the sake of the next generation. But God's up to some things, and we're just trying to say, God, we want to follow you. We want to be prepared. We want to be ready. We want to be ahead. There's some new initiatives next weekend. I'm going to announce that we're just saying, God, thank you for being good and faithful to us. And God, we want others to experience your hope, others to experience your love, others to experience the purpose that comes from following you. And so for the next few weeks, we're going to talk about some cultural distinctives. We've called them, this is us. Like, this is what it means to be a part of not just God's family, but specifically Hillside family. That we think that this is the kind of church God is inviting us to be. Specifically, we're going to talk today about this idea of serve somebody. We're servants. We're servants. And I don't know if that idea sounds radical to you or not, but here's what I want you to just think about for the next 40 minutes. 36 and 36 seconds, actually. It is a radical, culture-shaping idea to take the posture of a servant. In our society, that's not the way we roll. I've got some cups. I need a couple people to come and just take some of these cups and pass them out. Robert, you're ready. You look like you're ready. Pass these out. Okay, you're going to help. Just pass them out to a bunch of different people. Here's a few for you and a few for you. Thank you. So in this idea, in the Bible, but even in other forms of ancient literature, the cup has been a metaphor for like your lot in life, your experience in life, the way that God works in your life. If you have a cup, will you just hold your cup up real quick? Okay, if you have a coffee cup or a water with you, will you just hold that up real quick? Like, everybody can participate. If you don't, we're so sorry, but raise your hand just like this so we're in it together. These cups represent this idea of the lot we have in life, what has come our way, literature about our experience, whether joyous or whether adverse, divine appointments, whether favorable or unfavorable, like a cup which God presents one or life presents one to drink out of. What's going on in your life? You can put them down. But we're holding these as this metaphor of our thoughts, our feelings, our emotion. What's in our life, in our cup, is what comes out of us. And this summer, I read this book called Good Faith, and the authors, Kinnaman and Lyons, talk about this idea. We live in a world that has this perspective. They call it a new morality. I don't know how new it is, to be honest with you. But a new morality that our culture operates in. It's like the default mode of a human heart right now in 2017, particularly in America. And they have six guiding principles of this new moral code. We have a slide so you can see them for yourself. Here's the first. To find yourself, look within yourself. It's this idea. If you want to find yourself, if you want to discover who you are, it's in you. It's in your cup, in your thoughts, in your emotions, in your desires. To find yourself, look within yourself. The second principle is that people should not criticize someone else's life's choice. Like, you've got your cup, I've got my cup. You shouldn't say anything about mine. I shouldn't say anything about yours. Just mind your own business. There's no accountability. There's no interdependence or connectedness. Number three, to be fulfilled in life, pursue the things you desire most. To be fulfilled in life. It's all about you. It's all about what's in your cup. Four, enjoying yourself is the highest goal of life. Like, nothing could be better than enjoying yourself, enjoying life. Happy, happy, happy. It's all about you. People can believe whatever they want. Pause. As long as those beliefs don't affect society or interfere with anybody else. And then the sixth guiding principle is any kind of sexual expression between two consenting adults is fine. That these are guiding principles through which there's a new sort of mode of operation in our society that people are living by. Now, you may say, I don't know that I agree with any of those, or I don't know that I agree with all of those. But the dilemma is this. We live in a world that does. And even if we don't think we believe them, sometimes we live like that. Sometimes we live as if I've got all the answers. Sometimes we live as although if I'm going to be fulfilled or joyful or happy, it means I get my way. And then we go to Jesus. And Jesus says, maybe not. Jesus says, what if there's another way? What if there's another way for you to be fulfilled? What if there's another way for you to have joy? What if there's another way for you to find purpose? What if there's another way to find hope? And it's not your way. Would you be willing to say, okay, Jesus, I'll have it your way. Whatever you want. Whatever that means, I'll follow you. So that's what we're going to talk about today, a new way that Jesus calls us to live. If you have your Bibles, grab them, turn to Mark chapter 10. Or if you have a smartphone, a tablet, get online. Mark chapter 10 is where we're going to be. But I want to set up the context of where we're at, because I think it's so important to understanding exactly what's going on. The first eight chapters of Mark are primarily in one location. Jesus is teaching within the region of Galilee, and he's teaching his disciples. This is what it means to follow him. He's calling out his disciples. He's performing miracles. He's doing all of these works. Then you get somewhere around chapter 8, and for the first time, at least in Mark, Jesus is going somewhere, and he's like, let's go to Jerusalem. But what awaits him in Jerusalem? Betrayal, arrest, being mocked, being spat on, being abused, being mistreated, crucifying on a cross, dying, being buried, rising on the third day. But Jesus is, there's a transition, let's go to Jerusalem. So at the end of chapter 8, you'll see for the first time, Jesus comes to his disciples and he says something that wrecks them. He says, I'm going to die. And Peter stands up and he's like, Jesus, you're not going to die. You're the Messiah. Like, Peter's got it figured out better than Jesus. And Jesus, like, lovingly says, oh, Peter, get behind me, Satan. You don't know what you're talking about. And then they go on. And then you get to chapter 9. And towards the middle of chapter 9, for a second time, Jesus says, I'm going to be delivered in the hands of men. They're going to kill me. I'm going to rise after 3 days. He literally just says these words. And then he's like, come on, we got to go. So they go on a road and they're walking. And I imagine Jesus must be ahead of them as they're walking down the road. And while they're walking, the disciples get into an argument. And they're fighting with each other, but they don't want Jesus to hear, so they're like whisper fighting. And they're like, he likes me more. I'm going to be greater in God's kingdom than you. They're fighting about who's going to be the greatest disciple. And in verse 35, they finally get to their destination, and it says, sitting down, Jesus called the 12 and said, anyone who wants to be first must be the very last and the, what's the word? Hold on. What's the word? And the servant of all. In that moment, they're like, he knew we were fighting about who was going to be the greatest, and they're blushing and they're embarrassed, but they still don't get it. Then you get to chapter 10. And you see, starting in verse 32, for the third time, Jesus predicts his death. He says, I'm going to be delivered. I'm going to be betrayed. I will be condemned to death. I will be mocked. I will be spat on. I will be flogged. And then I will die on a cross. And 3 days later, I will rise again. And then you get to this section, verses 35 through 45, we're going to deal with this morning. But I want to start at the end of it, so I hope then it all makes sense. So look with me in verse 45. Here's Jesus' words. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to, what's the word?
Serve.
And give his life as a ransom for many. Jesus says, for the reason that I came, this is like a Christmas passage in August. The reason I came, the reason I was born was to serve. Jesus says that I didn't just come in the form of a king. I didn't just come as a Lord. I didn't just come as a savior. I didn't just come to rule. I came to serve you. This is the literal word in the Greek that you would have in our times for like a table waiter or a waitress. Jesus said, I came to serve you. See, other religions of the world all say that the God or the gods, they want our service. It's about what can you do for them. It's about your obedience and your effort, and you need to be better, try harder, work more to earn it. And Jesus said, that's not who I am. I came to serve you. I came to serve you. I came to serve all of those, the many, to give my life as a ransom. A ransom in that day is a payment so that something can be freed. I came to serve you. I came to give my life as a ransom for many. Jesus came to serve the broken. He came to serve the hurting. He came to serve the fearful. He came to serve the anxious. He came to serve the poor and the rich. He came to serve the ones who are broken and the ones who act like they've got it all together. He came to serve those who are desperate, and he came to serve those who are apathetic. He came to serve those who are so uncomfortable in life, and he came to serve those who are just way too comfortable in life. He came to serve, and he came to give his life as a ransom for many. And here's the deal. When we approach Jesus so many times, we're saying, here's what I have to offer, or here's what I want out of life, or here's my thoughts, my feelings, my desires, and we're hoping that Jesus will help us get our way. Well, what if our way is not the best way? And what if our way is not the way to truly have life? I need somebody to help me come up real quick. Somebody just be bold. Anybody? Robert's going to. Okay, come on. What if when we are presenting this and saying, Jesus, look what I have to offer. Just go ahead and pull that off and hand me the what's under it. And we say, Jesus, here's what I have. Here's what I have to offer. Here's what I want. And Jesus says, and here's what I have for you. Thank you, I'll keep it. Here's what I have for you. Like, you keep lifting up your way and you keep saying, but look what I have, or I'm trying, or if I could just get my way, then I would be fulfilled. And Jesus was saying, if you could just have my way, you wouldn't even have a clue how fulfilled you can be. So just to make sure you get this. It doesn't compare. And how much more would the inexhaustible grace, how much more would the unfailing love of God make our efforts pale in comparison? And so Jesus said, it's not about what you can do. It's not about what you have to offer. It's really all about who I am and what I have done. And you can trust me. And you can trust me. Jesus came to serve. And I just want to tell you, I am so glad he came to serve. I am so grateful when I was a six-year-old little boy on the front row at Alan J. Baptist Church, High Point, North Carolina, 6 years old. Yates M. Brooks is up there preaching the gospel of Jesus' love. And I thought my chest was going to, my heart leap out of my chest. I just knew what he was talking about I wanted. And when I went up and said, I need Jesus at 6 years old, that day Jesus served me, gave me grace, gave me a new start in life. And I was only 6 years old. But he changed my life that day. Anybody else grateful for that day where Jesus changed your life? I'm so grateful that when I was a knucklehead, I'm going to knock that off, so I just might as well knock it off now. When I was a knucklehead teenager running around doing my own thing, going my own way, that Jesus had grace. He redirected my life. He gave me a new kind of purpose. He said, don't be like that, but go this way, and he showed me grace. I'm so incredibly grateful as a college student, lonely, not knowing where to go, and there was a knock on my door. And the guys came and said, we're from InterVarsity Christian Fellowship. And I don't know what they said, but here's what I heard. Do you need a friend? And I was like, yes, I do. I do. And I saw Jesus serve me through other people. I'm so grateful that Jesus served me by giving me a wife, an amazing wife who loves God and loves me. Because here's the deal, like I dated other girls and it terrifies me to think I could have been married to one of them. But Jesus served me and gave me an amazing wife. He blessed us. Like I get it, he blessed us with three amazing children and we're so grateful that he served us through that and that in the midst of the last 8+ years of heartache and fear of loss of life and a cancer journey that he has served not just me, not just my wife, but all three of our kids. He's shown them that he's faithful. He has served us and he served us in such a way that even now they at young ages want to serve him. They love to be here on the weekend to serve you because Jesus has served them. We're so grateful. I'm so amazed that Jesus would take this introverted, shy, Southern Baptist, Bible Belt, born and raised dude who dropped classes in college because I had to speak in front of 30 people. And he said, long story short, I want you to be the pastor of Hillside Community Church. It doesn't make sense. It doesn't add up. But it's not because of my ability. It has nothing to do with my gifting. It has nothing to do with me. It has to do with his abundant supply. And he served me. He served me this morning at 6:00. I'm reading through my Bible plan that's on my phone, and I get to the next passage that I'm to read for the day, and it is Mark chapter 10. And in that is verses 35 through 45. So early this morning, I mean, you may say that's a coincidence. All I know is the more I seek God, the more coincidences seem to happen all around me. And he served me this morning by reminding me, stay rooted here. You need it. We need it. Stay rooted here. So let's get back to the text and see what the challenge of this is. It's the challenge of living life for ourselves. It's the challenge of the new morality in our time, but it's not really that new. So remember in verses 32 through 34, for the third time, Jesus had predicted his death. He had said, I'm going to die. I'm going to be mocked. I'm going to be spat on. I'm going to die. I'm going to be buried. And immediately after that, verse 35, look what happened. Then James and John, the sons of Zebedee, they're brothers. They're known, they have a nickname, the Sons of Thunder. So they must have been pretty bad dudes at something. I don't know. Sons of Thunder. That's pretty good. They came to him and they said, teacher, we want you to do for us whatever we ask. Like that's pretty audacious. Hey, teacher, we want you to do whatever we ask. And they've seen him do some pretty crazy things. He's walked on water. He's calmed storms. He's healed. We want you to do whatever we ask. Jesus says, what do you want me to do for you? Even in the asking, he's sort of trying to unveil the selfishness, the pride behind the actual question. What do you want me to do for you? So verse 37, they replied, let one of us sit at your right and the other at your left in your glory. Verse 38, you don't know what you are asking, Jesus said. Can you drink the cup, interesting that I drink, or be baptized with the baptism I am baptized with. Verse 39, we can, they answered. Like Jesus comes to them and he's asking this, or they come to him first of all, asking this question, we want you to do for us whatever we ask, yet it's rooted completely in this, so that I can be fulfilled, so that I can get my way, so that I can be served and have what I want. It's not about what Jesus is saying. He's already doing. He's already at work if they would just see. They want him to do exactly what they are hoping for. Now, interestingly, get this idea. The two brothers probably pulled Jesus aside. They're like, Jesus, we need to talk to you for a minute. Jesus, come over here. Hey, Jesus, we want you to do for us, just the two of us, whatever we ask you. But all this while, there's 10 other disciples maybe over here And they can hear the whole thing, and they're like, what are they doing? Why are they asking that? So look at verse 41. It says, when the 10 heard about this, they became indignant with James and John. When they heard what they were asking, they were furious. Why? Because they were jealous. They wanted to ask the same question beforehand. And here's what's interesting. Even though Jesus rebukes the two, the 10 still want to be identified with the two who asked for a foolish, selfish thing instead of Jesus' offer. So then look how Jesus explains this. Verse 42, he called them together. Hey boys, we need to talk. A little family meeting here. You know those who are regarded as rulers of the Gentiles lorded over them, and their high officials exercised authority over them. In that time, the Gentiles, the Roman authorities over them, they ruled with an iron fist. They manipulated. They took advantage of the common person for their own advantage. Like this would be like a cruel politician. This would be like a boss that just uses and abuses you. This is ruling by like power and position and privilege, but not really caring. And Jesus said, you know how that is when you're with someone who uses their power like that. Here's what Jesus says, verse 43, not so with you. Not so with you. It's not about power and privilege. It's not about entitlement. Well, I deserve this. Well, it's not fair. Not so with you. Instead, Jesus says, whoever wants to become great among you must be your, what's the word? Servant. And whoever wants to be first must be slave of all. Not so with you. This is a culture-shifting moment where Jesus is telling his disciples, there's a certain quality of character that I'm hoping that you'll have. There's a certain approach and attitude, a posture of your life that I'm praying that you will have. There's a different way of doing life that's not about what's in it for me, that's not about I'll be fulfilled if I get my way. It's a different kind of life that is rooted in all that God has for us in Jesus. Whoever wants to become great among you must be your servant. Here's what I think is amazing. Jesus doesn't go after them and say, I can't believe you want to be great. I can't believe you want to have influence. I can't believe you want to make a difference. He doesn't go after that at all. He redefines what greatness is like. He redefines what it means to have influence. I had a teacher after the last gathering come and say, thank you so much for pointing me back to that scripture because I'm going to school tomorrow as a servant, not just a teacher. Students, you're going to school tomorrow not just as a student, but as a servant. And some of you don't have to go back to school tomorrow, so sleep in and enjoy for two or three more weeks. And clap, but your time is coming. And when you're still in school in June, and we're at the beach in May, it's all fair. He doesn't go after this ambition. He doesn't go after this desire to make a difference. He says, if you want to do it, then you got to do it the right way. Be a servant. Be a servant. Learn to put others ahead of yourselves. If you want to find out what fulfillment is, Jesus radically redefines. We're told in our culture that if you want to be fulfilled, it's the answer's in you. The answer's you getting your way. If you want to experience life, it's about you being happy. And Jesus says, no, it's not. Jesus says, I've got so much more for you. And if you want to experience it, it may begin with you taking the posture of a servant. I've had three conversations at least in the last few weeks on this exact issue. And most of it has been people telling me some things. There's a lady who was sharing with me a deep, deep broken place in her life, a place of hurt and a place of pain. And she said, I felt broken. I just didn't even know if God could use me anymore right now. And she said, then I got a phone call a couple of Saturday nights ago, and I was invited to come and serve in the preschool area because some people were on vacation and they had a place where they needed some servants. And so she went up there and she said, I was broken. I was hurting. I walked into that place fearful and just anxious. And I walked into this room and there was this one little girl who came running up to me and just latched onto me. And she said, gave me attention. And she said, I didn't know this, but that little girl is like mommy's girl. She doesn't usually go to other people. And she said, I was holding this little girl, and the whole entire service, I was holding this girl, and then her father came to pick her up, and he's like, whoa, what is she doing with you? She doesn't go to anybody. So then he went and got the mom to make sure the mom understands this. And so this lady's telling me, I'm just sitting there holding this little girl the whole time. Like, and my heart is healing minute by minute by minute by minute by minute by minute. And she said, I didn't know that healing would come through serving, but I experienced God do something through this serving in the preschool area. It changed my life. I met another lady this past week, and she said, we're brand new to the area. We moved from out of state, and we are just convinced. Like, we want to be connected. We want to be in relationship with others, and we are convinced that it's not going to happen if we just sit around. We've got to serve to find a place to connect and to connect with others. And I was like, can you preach the sermon this weekend? It's a good line. I was talking to a young guy at the beach Wednesday night. We had the privilege of having 200 or so junior hires and high schoolers at a beach bonfire Wednesday night. Right? Are you guys here? Anybody here? Some of the high schoolers are here? 200. It just reaffirmed my call in life is not to student ministries. Like, yes! So grateful for those of you who love and serve our students. It was an amazing night. But a young guy came to me and said, I think God's calling me to be a pastor. Do you have any advice of first steps? And that fast it popped in my head. I said, yes, start serving faithfully somewhere. Because we discover as we serve purpose, we discover our gifts, we discover our passions, not when we just simply sit back and think through it. That there's a time for that, but when we actually start serving, God starts speaking. If you're not connected, but you want to be, maybe it's time to stop sitting around. If you're hurting and you're desiring to be healthy and to experience healing, maybe it happens as you engage in serving. If you're looking for purpose and you're looking for next steps, maybe it will begin to be revealed as you start walking and stepping out in faith. Jesus says, we've got to learn what it means to be a servant. To be a servant. To say that we're a part of something. We've got gifts and we've got talents and we've got abilities, and they're not for just our own use, for ourselves. Peter says it this way in 1 Peter chapter 4. He says that each one of us should use whatever gift that you have received to what? Serve others. To serve somebody. We should use whatever gift that we've been given. We should use whatever resources God has entrusted us, how He's created us, how He's formed us and fashioned us. Use those gifts to serve others. As I was just thinking this week about all of the men and women, all of the high schoolers, all of the junior hires who serve on any given week here at Hillside, and the difference that they're making, the difference that you're making. Like, when you serve, or when you pray, or when you give, you have a part of celebration, because you're a participant in 59 people who were baptized. You are a participant in the life change that is happening and the story that God is doing all over this place. And it made me start thinking back in my mind when I grew up in this church that we just didn't have children in the, like, adult service. Children stayed downstairs in the dungeon in children's ministry. My first time getting upstairs in the adult service, I've told this before, literally, I'm not kidding, a fight broke out in the service. And the next week, we had started a new church and we never went back to that other church again. That's what we like to call, not a church plant, that's a hate plant. We started for maybe wrong reasons, but whatever. A couple years into this new church, we called this church Cornerstone Baptist Church. I'll never forget. I think my aunt actually came up with the name for this church, Cornerstone. A couple years into it, we bought land and we built a building. We have a picture of it. I want you to see. That's the church. And when I say we built the building, here's what I mean. Like, we literally built the building. We didn't hire contractors. Like, we're like, anybody got a hammer? Show up at the church. We're going to build it. So as a junior hire, I was invited. I climbed through the rafters with a hammer and nails. What were they thinking? It's a miracle that thing is still standing. Like at least they didn't give me a skill saw, but they were like, here's a hammer, go nail something. I'm like, sweet. I'm crawling through rafters. And we built that church. And I was invited as a junior hire. You matter. And your time and your energy and your skill, although it was a little skill, it matters. So all hands on deck, let's be a part of this. So I remember vividly people like Katie Hawks and her husband Bill Hawks that would serve us faithfully and poured into my life. I remember Clinton Brown when I was 5 years old. He had been my Sunday school teacher already at that point for years. And for years more, 5 years old, he looked at me and he said, young man, you're going to be a preacher one day. And I wanted to say, oh man, you're crazy. But I didn't. And then I remember Joe Gillespie year after year after year pouring in. Here's what I want to say. I would not be who I am today without these people pouring into my life. I remember for years growing up, little old ladies would come to me and take my cheeks. And I remember changing your diaper in the nursery. I'm like, please don't tell me that. Like, I'm already scarred enough. I don't need any more of that. But their faithful service year after year after year, I wouldn't be where I am today without the investment. And that's the same thing that's true of our church. For 38 years, some in this room have faithfully, faithfully served and given. Some of you, for not that long, but for years, some of you have been a part. And here's the beautiful thing. Paul talks about in 1 Corinthians that the church is like a physical body. Like we're all supposed to be together. And just like my body has knees and ankles and fingers and toes and hair and a chin and ears and a nose. I just wrapped that. I rhymed that. My body, in order to fully function, needs all of the parts to do their part. And the church operates best when we all do the part we've been designed, called to. So for a few minutes, just listen. If you call Hillside Community Church your home, there's an invitation. This is like culture changing stuff. This is us. We are servants. We're servant leaders. Or at least we want to be. That's what we believe Jesus has called us to be. Not spectators who sit on the sidelines and watch or give advice or shout out plays that we want other people to do. We're servants. We're servants who have first been served by Jesus. We've been called, we've been created, we've been gifted and empowered by His Holy Spirit to be who God has created us to be. Servants. Servants. Maybe you're here and you're tired. Maybe you're here and you're frustrated. Maybe you're here and you're exhausted. Maybe you're here and you feel like nobody else pays attention. Let Jesus serve you. Let Him pour out grace and love and hope and purpose in your life. Because, reminder, as this passage ends, Jesus says, for even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to what? But to serve. We've said this for a while here, that saved people serve people. It's the idea that if we've been rescued by Jesus, we serve people. Maybe for today's purposes, it's even more appropriate to say, served people serve people. So if you've been served, it's not, if Jesus has loved you, given you grace, rescued you, it's not just so you can sit back and watch. It's not so you can just say, well, here's my preference, or here's what I'm wanting, or the church didn't serve me. Guess what? That's Jesus's job. Our role is to serve others. It's not about us, but then He does fill us up with His inexhaustible resources so that we overflow, so that our lives make a difference. See, this is us. This is who God is calling us to be. And when we are all about what's in it for me, and we're all about my perspective, and we're all about my time and my resources, we may just miss the beauty of Jesus' church. We just finished a series in Ephesians. And Ephesians is all about God's work through the church. that we've all been gifted in various ways, that pastors, my job is not to do all of the work. My job is to equip all of you to do the work of the ministry. That's what Scripture says. It's never about one person or a small team. It's about all of us doing our part. So let me get very, very specific for just a minute, and then I'll not be. If you are here and you're still sitting and not serving, I've got just three things I want to share with you, three opportunities to say you, in your life, you could make an unbelievable difference. The first is this. In Hillside Kids, preschool and elementary, there are unbelievable opportunities to shape the next generation. And sometimes you shape the next generation by simply changing somebody's diaper so their parents can be in here and hear the gospel. Sometimes you shape a next generation by giving them goldfish so that they can actually pay attention and their bellies aren't growling and they can hear. Sometimes you shape the next generation by welcoming or helping check in or whatever, or teaching a lesson eventually. But there are unbelievable opportunities to be a part of shaping the next generation. And here's all that you have to do. Sign up. You'll get a background check. We'll make sure, you know, you're not a felon in the wrong ways. And then you could serve. Number two, guest experiences. From our shuttle drivers to our parking lot to our ushers and our greeters, we want to be the most welcoming place in this entire area. We would love to invite more of you to say good morning to someone, to high five or hug or handshake. Good to see you today, to be a friendly face. Number three, in our tech production, cameras and all kinds of things like that. Our camera people are going crazy right now. Here's the deal. You don't even have to have the skill. We'll train you, or they'll train you, because I don't have any skill. They'll train you. But like I said, we've got some new initiatives I'm going to talk about next week we're launching into, where we believe God is up to some radical things. It's a new day. It's a new day. And we're wanting to really just call all of us to be all in, to serve somebody, because Jesus has first served us. Monday is usually my study day, so I was at home. It was a beautiful day because my wife and kids all had plans. I had the house to myself, and I just studied. And I had one of those light bulb kind of moments, because I was thinking about the cup, and I was thinking about the way that Jesus has served us, and I hadn't connected the dots. My light bulb moment was, this weekend is communion weekend. Huh. And I just had this image of the cup. The communion cup that Jesus so often talks about. The cup that at the Last Supper, where Jesus said, this cup is a new covenant in my blood. The same cup metaphor that in the garden, Jesus in agony was crying out, if possible, Father, let this cup be taken from me. But Jesus said, nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. The cup is this idea that Jesus took the suffering, the wrath, the punishment that my sins, our sins deserved on himself so that we could be free. He gave his life as a ransom for many. And so Jesus has served us by sacrificing his life. And so today we are invited, those of us who follow Jesus, as we take communion, to remember how he has served us. So when we take that bread that represents the body of Jesus on a cross for us, just as he said would happen, we remember we are free. There's grace has been given through Jesus. And when we take the cup that represents in a small, tangible way all of the things Jesus accomplished for us, that juice in that cup reminds us of the blood that was shed so we can be forgiven. His innocent and holy blood for us. And so we're going to take communion in just a minute as a reminder that Jesus has served us so well, so faithfully, and as an invitation to then go and serve others, to do something with what Christ has done to us. We've got a team all out in the lobby with these Serve Somebody shirts to sign you up today. You can go on the app, you can do it right now. And all that stuff is important, but what is most important right now is to remember this. What Jesus has done on our behalf, what we remember through communion, is most important. It's foundational. And so I want to invite some of you who are tired to come and receive today. Some of you who are burdened to remember today. Some of you who are afraid, you're anxious to receive today. Some of you who have been sitting today say, I'm all in to step up, to sign up, to start serving because you've been served so well. Will you pray with me? God, thank you for today and for this time, but most of all for your love, for your grace. And we're asking you today to just remind us of your goodness, remind us of your grace. When we try to take on this small cup of our life, of our feelings, of our thinking, of our worldview, and we neglect your way, we neglect all that you have done and accomplished for us, we want to experience, we want to know you, we want to remember you. So we pray that you would serve us today for the one that's hurting, the one that's discouraged, the one that's just so full of anxiety, for the one who feels like they're at the end of their rope. God, would you please break through? Jesus, serve them. For the person who feels like, I've got everything I can earn, I've got everything I can accomplish, would you show them you have even more? You are a God who does exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or imagine. So we remember your grace in this moment. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.